I was asked to give you some information, some general information about the possibilities of dating in the scope, in the interval range that the researcher that study megalithic structures can need, no? Because luminescence dating can date in a very wide range. So I will focus. I have here, I prepared a small PowerPoint. So I will give you some topics, and at the end, try to do some details. So we are talking about the process of dating some burial structures, so in scope of Neolithic. In this research studies, we should always have a team, not only of archaeologists, but also other researchers from other disciplines that can provide a very good geoarchaeology. So I'm talking about that the archaeologists that investigate a site should have in the team, and these persons, these colleagues, should visit the site periodically in order to give some advices. I'm talking about a stratigrapher, a sedimentologist, maybe in some case a geomorphologist to understand the human occupation and how they use the researchers, etc. And also the person that will do the absolute dating. And the absolute dating can be done on this time interval by several methods. The C14, if there is available some organic material of that age, but we have problems with modern trees, etc. And one that is very interesting is the luminescence dating that I will focus. So luminescence dating can use several types of materials, from stones, from ceramics, from even cemetery grains like quartz or feldspar. So those materials are the dosimeters. So the materials, why I cannot move. Okay. So luminescence dating, we use to date from, in some cases, from 10 years to 600 or 800,000 years. Okay. But that depends of the mineral that we used and also the dose rate. Okay. I will explain. Regarding this topic is the dating Neolithic sites. Here the problem is different, okay? Because normally these sites have very limited associated sediments and they are very heterometric. And this is a major problem for the OSL dating, the dating of sediments, of grains. But there is a promising alternative that is dating lithic surfaces. So you have a pillar and you can date a part of that pillar by taking just a piece of rock that is still covered with sediment. So we have to extract that by night, okay? Or under a cover situation. So regarding OSL dating, in some cases, for instance, a terrace staircase, and in some cases we have materials in terraces, in situ, that is not really normally the case for Neolithic, that only in some cases the Neolithic are in the alluvial plain sediments. So you see, I don't know if you have the pointer. Yes, I can have the pointer here. So you see here the text. So you see here the alluvial plain, okay, my A, okay? So it's a little moved. Okay, so you can date, but most of the sites are not in the alluvial plain, are in hills, in slopes, okay? So moving on. The sediments, when they are buried, they get a dose because of the radioactivity and also by cosmogenic race. And what we have, we have to collect, for instance, sediment, and later we have to measure the dose rate. And dividing one by the other, we can get the age. Okay? That is the principle of luminescence dating or electrospin dating. So, you have here three approaches. You are seeing these three samples, sediment, okay? Mm-hmm. So, in this case, we cannot have daylight exposure. So, normally, if we have suns, we insert a tube, normally a metallic tube, not to be blocked or broken. Or we have to cover it with a very thick black plastic in order to do the sampling in very dark conditions. Okay? We cannot expose sediment to light. Okay? If we expose the time, the clock, the dose that is preserved will be zero. And we cannot date, we get a zero age. But we also can date ceramics. So if you are excavating a megalithic tomb and you look a piece of a ceramic, what you can do is you can cover the place and take that ceramic and sediment that is around, cover it in an aluminum fold and put in a, for on those aluminum cups that you use for food, okay? But that should be in a covered situation. So you have to take out the sunlight or do by night with a bicycle red light, okay? So in this case, this material that is covered will be sent to a lab and we'll do all quartz OSL dating in the ceramic and use the sediment that is around, that should be about 300 grams, to get the value for the dose rate. And the age is the dose divided by dose rate. Okay? So, moving to the next one. Okay, so this is the normal sampling of sediments. Here, for instance, if you sample, do a trench in an alluvial plain, you could find some archaeological Neolithic artifacts or structures, and you can date just putting a tube just above and below, and you more or less will know the age of the structure. Okay, that is an approach. Another one will be, for instance, in certain sites there is a lot of heterometry, and we should select for collecting a tube, an area that is homogeneous, because the value of dose rate should not change in space. So if you are dividing by a value that is not really good for the samples that we are measuring the equivalent dose, we'll get not very good age. Next one. So here you see that there are two problems. One, that we should not sample near the surface. So for OSL sampling, we should not sample on the alpha meter below the surface, because normally it's very reworked by men or by trees, the roots of trees, and also diaclase, they can open, put light inside, okay? And this difficult to modelize the influence of the cosmogenic radiation to increase the dose, okay? The dose rate that was affected the grape. So that is also a main problem for the Neolithic tombs. The other is, if I sample, you can see on the slide on the left, if I sample sand, that very small bed of sand, that is of the Lisbon tsunami, okay, you see? But I also need to take samples from the clay below and above, and because they have much a much higher dose rate. And in the lab, they have to do a model for the influence of all the space that can influence the grains, getting it dose, in order to have a more accurate value for the dose rate, okay? So all these are problems that should be addressed by a specialist. As archaeologist, you should not read something in a book and try by yourself to do the sampling. You will spend money and you will get very bad results. And you don't know that your results are bad. That is the main problem. And you try to force your results, your very good archaeological data, to be suitable to that bad age. Okay? So that is a major problem. You should always get the support in collaborative research by a specialist of OSL dating. Okay, in this case, I am showing you, for instance, that is an earlier night, but I could show you a menhir, a Portuguese anta, a structure with lithic surfaces. And in those rocks, we cannot insert a tube, but we can take a block, okay? And later we can date that block. In this case, if it's cemented sandstone, I will disaggregate in my lab using ACL. But in case of a menhir, of a lithic structure, we can take a cutting with a saw by night, a piece of the part of the structure, the lithical pillar, that was still covered with sediment, okay? So next one, this is an example of heterometric sediments. I have an approach that can date heterometric sediments that gives me a lot of work to get a good estimation of the dose rate, okay? But this is only for very special cases that you could need. In some cases, there are Neolithic tomb sites with very heterometric sediments, like this one. And this is the method for getting the dose rate. So in some cases, the person use a portable gamma ray spectrometer. You see that instrument on the top photo to the right. So it's a portable gamma ray spectrometer. It gives a value for dose rate. It's not so precise as the high resolution gamma ray spectrometer. Okay, that is we have here. This is Andrew Murray, that is the director of Nordic Laboratory for Luminescence Dating, still very active where I am at the moment, at the end more or less of my fifth month, and I will be here for until the end of June. Okay, they have here three high resolution spectrometers. Nobody, I don't know a lab in the world that have this number of spectrometers. So this is the room where we put the grains of quartz and feldspar to measure the equivalent dose. You see, we have several approaches, large aliquots, small aliquots, or single grains for the historic, in some cases, Neolithic sites. We have to use single grains. I can explain later in discussion this. Okay, so rock surface. This is very important for you. This is a new method. So now is the very new development year in DTU or NLL. They are very interested in developing this technique. They are using quartzites, quartz pebbles. They are using granites, whatever. This is very useful for the studies of Neolithic. So conclusions: we can by OSL we can date a very large of sites, getting very reliable burial ages. So you can date sediments, the archaeological materials, but we have to consider several factors. So and for this, collaboration of a researcher that knows how to sample and the problems that could be there is, I think, crucial. So the sample strategy is very important. For old samples, we have the problem of having age saturation, but it's not really the case, the problem for Neolithic. And finally, I will say the we use the still use the Quartz OSL SAR method, that is a routine method, but the problem is the approach. So we can date sediments, but we have the problem with the reliable value for dose rate. That is the problem. In the case of lithic, dating lithic structures, we have the problem of approach and knowing if that material has feldspar or suitable quartz to be dated. Okay? So I will finish. I'll be, this is my example of site. We can see all my publications. Even the better is to put in your seed, Pedro P. Cunha, and get my all my records there. Ask me, and I will send you the PDF. And also, I produced also some papers, or in Brazilian, in Portuguese, or in English, so I can send them to you if you ask me. So now, if I still have some minutes, I'll be available for questions.
Thank you, Pedro. Thank you very much. We've been working together for some time. I think that the surface dating will be really a breakthrough in prehistoric investigation. But I'm very curious if João Carlos Sena Martínez would have any question, because he's been working in dolmens now for decades. And I wonder if he has some question to do and some comments, because that would be a breakthrough. I think that going through the sites and sampling. Let me ask you something. In the case of a dolmen, and you have these big rocks, you know, those large rocks.
Yes.
So the top of them will be exposed, but the bottom will be not, will be buried. Will that exposure will interfere with the measurements? Are the radiation pass?
Okay, so I visited recently with John Canina, the ANTA, that he was excavating in near Prensa Nova. What is the name of that
big Cabeça-Dente.
Yes. And he wanted to, one of us, Reza Sabati, that is really one of the first in the world that developed the surface staging, to go there. But Reza was very busy here and could not there. And also we had the pandemic, so we had several problems. So in the case of that ANTA, what was? I told João that before they excavate completely down, okay, they could have access to the base of a pillar, okay, by night, for instance, or doing the sampling with a cover of black plastic to have dark conditions, okay? In that case, what we'll do? We can do two things. We can collect a little a piece of rock of the pillar, having the surface and a little more, because later in the lab they will drill. They will drill from the surface and getting a Lacoste to be measured and do a luminescence profile. And they could have age of the exposure of that pillar. So we'll know when they transported, last time they transported the pillar from the original position, geological position, to the monument. And that exposure stopped when they put sediments in order to put the pillar stable, okay? And we can also take a tube of the sediments that are around, okay? The problem is always we don't know if those sediments were taken from a nearby colluvian and they were not really exposed to light. In the case of a MAMOA that is that I collaborate with João Caninas near Miranda do Corvo, Lausanne.
Mm-hmm.
So they excavate, era a mamô, I cannot remember now the name of it. Paulo.
Penadinho Branco.
Em Miranda do Corvo. Exato. So what I discovered, that the mount had a cover of blocks of quartz vein. Okay, they like that because they will be seen from every side. Okay, because they will reflect the light of sun. But mm-hmm. below that, there was a bed of sand, fine sand, and below that we have the structure, the rocks, the pillars, and also sediments. Okay, so what I understand, they get from a nearby sand that was by physical erosion, by physical weathering, disaggregated from the metagrovax nearby. Now, metagrovax is a sandstone, mm-hmm. a metamorphic sandstone. So, in the condition, the cold conditions, move the sun near about, and what they decided, when they do the structure, the last part they put sand, covered with this sand, that is more or less alien sand, and put the blocks of quartz vein on the top, on the sand. So what I did, I dated the sand, because the sand bed had the good thickness to get, and the good quartz grains to get a very reliable age. And so we published the age in that publication that we have in a book. I can later give you the reference.
Okay. And how much do you need of rock? How much is it necessary for the...
Not really too much. I think like a big match box.
Okay.
I will say about, I don't know the size they sample, but I think maybe 5 to a square of 5 centimeters to at least 3 centimeters of depth below the surface.
Okay.
And they use a saw to cut it. Okay? Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay.
May I?
Thank you. Yes, Rome, please.
I would like to put some questions. The explanation on how to date a stone upright, okay, it's easy to understand, but is destructive. And the question is, could the sample be drilled inside?
No, because we have always to have, so the specialist of luminescence dating, of surface luminescence dating, should go to the site and we'll select, for instance, there is
okay,
in this
that
moment.
I understood. What I'm asking is a different thing.
But that is not. Can we have to drill in the lab that piece of rock.
Okay, so you have always to cut a piece of
yes.
the rock.
But, for instance, this moment, for instance, you know that is a beautiful finding at Koa, the graving. So, there is a problem of dating that. But Thierry is already contacting this lab to do the dating. So, we should not sample in the engraving, but you can sample the same rock nearby, so 1 meter away or whatever, where she is that position that is still covered with sediment. So we don't affect, and later we can cover again with sediments. That will be not affect the value, the patrimony, the heritage value of the monument. So the collaboration between the archaeologist and the person that do the dating should be very close in order to avoid any damage.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, if we don't have any more questions? No? Well, in that case, I will want to thank Pedro for being available today, this morning. I know he's with a lot of work, and already have the facilities available, so I would not take him more time. Pedro, thank you very much for being here today, this morning, And I hope to see you soon and in Proença 1 year from now.
Yes, so sorry for my mess in the presentation, but I just had an overload of tasks here because the campus recently opened partially, so I get overload with tasks. And even I'm not very familiar with Zoom, I use other platforms like Skype. And so I please apologize me for not putting things right.
No worries, okay? No worries. Thank you very much, Pedro.
Okay, see you later.
See you later.
We'll be in contact, okay?
Okay, see you.